Even if you've never been caught in a particularly nasty hailstorm, you can probably visualize how a bunch of ice balls falling from the sky might interrupt your day. But in some parts of our planet, that day becomes intermittent storms spanning not just weeks, but months. And if you're looking for the superlative, the area that you could call the hailiest place on Earth, you should start by looking at Kericho County, Kenya. Over the years, research has claimed the region receives anywhere from 50 hailstorms per year to more than 200, which means it has been a prime target over the years for scientists trying to figure out ways to stop hail from hitting the ground. And believe it or not, one of those ways was shooting clouds with rockets. Hail is more than just annoying for the people living in Kericho. It can seriously damage buildings, animals, and crops. And the most important farmed plant in this area of the world is tea. Kenya is the world's third largest producer of tea, and Kericho County is one of its major tea hubs. For you map fans out there, Kericho is right about here, east of Lake Victoria and relatively close to the Earth's equator. It also sits about 2 kilometers above sea level. But I'm not telling you this just to help you find Kericho on a map. It is thanks to this location that it has a nice amount of rainfall and a consistent, warm, tropical climate. In other words, it's a perfect place for growing tea plants all year long. But, and this is a big but, dozens, if not hundreds of times every year, the valuable and vulnerable tea plants of Kericho get battered by hailstorms, because many of the same factors that make Kericho great for tea growing also make it great for hail. If you want to make some hail, first, you need a big cloud full of water that can precipitate on some unsuspecting tea plants, or an uncovered parking lot full of brand new cars. That cloud also needs to be at a high enough altitude for the temperatures to be cold enough that its precipitation will freeze, because otherwise, you just get rain. Next, you need really warm air below the cloud, which the Kericho region has thanks to its tropical climate. This air will form updrafts that, as the word implies, lift the precipitation back up into the sky as it tries to fall over and over again. And finally, you need a bunch of something called either ice nucleators or nucleation sites. Anything layers of ice can latch onto and build hail into larger and larger stones until they get so heavy that the updrafts can't keep them from hitting the ground anymore. And then boom, the hail's too heavy to keep getting lifted up, and it falls, and that's a hailstorm. Also, speaking of hitting the ground, because Kericho is so far above sea level, these hailstones have less distance to fall and less time to melt, meaning there's a greater chance that the hailstorm actually gets recorded as such and not a rainstorm. Now, a nucleation site for a hailstone could just be a raindrop, but it helps if there are minerals or even bacteria floating in the air that can serve as the jumping-off point. And back in 1982, some scientists proposed that Kericho's tea litter, that is, little bits of dead tea plants, could release compounds that serve as nucleation sites for the hail that is damaging those very crops.
This SciShow video is supported by Jump, a statistical analysis software that makes powerful analytics quick and accessible. At SciShow, we believe that education is a human right, and Jump is right there with us as a software based on the idea that statistics should be accessible to everyone. Jump is founded on the principle that there's a visualization for every statistic, and that's how we figure out what data means. The software is jam-packed with tools for data preparation, analysis, graphing, and so much more, making it easy to go from raw data to meaningful analysis in just a few clicks, with no coding required. Jump helps you generate everything from statistics to word clouds. Plus, Jump integrates R, Python, and SQL support for smooth analytic workflows. It basically doesn't matter what kind of file your data is coming from or what coding language you're working with. Jump works with the systems you already have in place. Jump offers a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere. To see the benefits of visual statistics for yourself, you can go to jmp.com/scishow.
Now, I say all of this as if it is super simple, straightforward, and obvious, but untangling the messy science of hail formation took many dedicated people thousands of hours flying armored planes into thunderstorms. That's how important understanding hail is for agriculture. And as scientists figured out many of the details about how hail forms, they also tried figuring out ways to stop it from forming, or at least stop it from forming stones that were big enough to cause damage. And in Kericho, most of the hail suppression depression tests took place in the 1960s and 70s. The researchers, often funded by companies who had a vested interest in protecting their tea profits, opted to test at least two methods of suppressing hail. The first was both straightforward and extreme. Fire rockets into thunderstorms and explode them. The explosion was meant to disrupt the air currents that form the hail and possibly break bigger hailstones into smaller, less damaging ones. And while this sounds like kind of a silly idea to me, from the get-go, apparently scientists thought it might work. It, however, did not work. It doesn't work in a laboratory setting, and it's never been proven to work in the field either. But hey, that's the scientific method for you. You come up with a hypothesis that we can blow up a hailstorm, and then you test it by trying to blow up a hailstorm. The second method for stopping hail was deployed from at least 1967 to 1975, and it involved releasing silver iodide into a hail-forming cloud at just the right time so that the particles could act as extra nucleation sites. This strategy depends on the assumption that there is only so much freezable water in a cloud, and by dispersing it over a larger number of hailstones, you can make the average hailstone much smaller. So small, in fact, that it might even melt before it hits the ground and any tea leaves growing out of it. According to a report published in 1975, this seemed to be somewhat successful. The author claimed that over a little more than 7 years of seeding more than 5,700 different cloud cells, there was a 40% reduction in damage to the tea crop found across Kericho and nearby Nandi Hills. However, when we dove into the literature, we were not able to find any follow-up experiments, just a grant proposal for another experiment that was approved in 1977 with no resulting paper. So while Kericho's hail suppression program seems to have fizzled out in the 1970s, Kericho's hail problem has gotten worse, and it may very well be thanks to our old enemy, climate change. Over the past few decades, some locals have noticed that hailstorms are happening outside of the usual yearly schedule, but the individual hailstones are getting larger too. Maybe Kenyan stakeholders will find alternative solutions to manage this growing problem, like growing hardier species of tea or building more greenhouses that can withstand getting pummeled by these bigger, badder storms. Or maybe they'll work with scientists to reopen local hail suppression research. If so, they will be happy to hear that this is still an active field in a bunch of places around the world. Like in Alberta, Canada, where they've had a program that uses planes to seed clouds with silver iodide pyrotechnics since 1966. But here's the thing. Even though various groups have been trying to suppress hail with silver iodide for more than 50 years, we still don't know if it actually works. The people doing it always claim it works, but randomized control trials find it has little effect. Until we have a confirmed solution, the people of Kericho will continue to live with a lot of hail. But at the very least, their weekly weather report won't also include a forecast of exploding rockets.